ஆஃப் எலக்ட்ரிக்கல் எலக்ட்ரானிக்ஸ் இன்ஜினியரிங் டிவிஎஸ்ஐடி காவலி. ஸோ இந்த ஃப்ளெக்சிபிள் ஏசி டிரான்ஸ்மிஷன் சிஸ்டம் ஆக்சுவலி இந்த ப்ரீவியஸ் கிளாஸ் ஐ டிஸ்கஸ்ட் அபவுட் இன்ட்ரடக்ஷன் அபவுட் ஃப்ளெக்சிபிள் ஏசி டிரான்ஸ்மிஷன் சிஸ்டம்ஸ் ஓகே அண்ட் நீட் ஃபார் டிரான்ஸ்மிஷன் அண்ட் இன்டர்கனெக்ஷன்ஸ் ஓகே அண்ட் ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டிஸ் ஃபார் ஃபேக்ட்ஸ். ஸோ நவ் இன் திஸ் கிளாஸ் ஐ எம் கோயிங் டு டிஸ்கஸ் ஃப்ளோ ஆஃப் பவர் இன் ஏசி சிஸ்டம்ஸ். திஸ் இஸ் அ வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் கான்செப்ட் இன் திஸ் சாப்டர். ஓகே, பவர் ஃப்ளோ இன் ஏசி சிஸ்டம்ஸ். So actually power flow in AC system, so actually at present many transmission facilities comfort one or more limiting network parameters. Okay, at present many transmission facilities comfort one or more limiting network parameters and plus the inability to direct power flow at will. So actually in this session I am going to discuss some important concepts in the power flow in AC systems. So actually in AC power systems the electrical generation and load must balance at all times. So actually in AC power systems the electrical generation and load must balance at all times. To some extent the electrical system is self-regulating. Okay, so in the AC power systems the electrical generation and load must be balanced at all times. So if the generation is less than the load, for example if you take the generation is less than the load, so in this case the voltage and frequency will drop. Okay, if the generation is less than the load, so at that time the voltage and frequency will drop. So however there is only a few percent margin for such a self regulation. So if there is inadequate reactive power support, so if there is inadequate reactive power support means unbalanced, inadequate means unbalances. So if there is inadequate reactive power support the system can have voltage collapse. Okay, so if the generation is less than the load, at that situation the voltage and frequency will drop. However there is only a few percent margin for such a self regulation. If there is inadequate reactive power support the system can have voltage collapse. Okay, so if we see another situation, that is when adequate generation is available. So previously we saw the inadequate reactive power support, and in this case we are seeing that when adequate generation is available, so in this case active power flows from the surplus generation areas to deficit areas. Surplus generation area means main generating area. Surplus generation area means nothing but power plants, etc. Okay, these are the generation areas. So here the active power flows from the surplus generation area to deficit areas through all parallel paths available, which frequently involves extra high voltage, EHV. Shortcutly we will call as EHV, extra high voltage and medium voltage lines. Okay, so when adequate generation is available active power flows from the surplus generation area to deficit areas, that is from source to load, nothing but source to load, surplus generation areas to deficit areas through all parallel paths available, which frequently involves EHV and medium voltage lines. That means high voltage lines and medium voltage lines. Okay, so this is the flow of power in an AC system. Okay, next we are going to see the power flow in parallel paths. Okay, here I am taking one power flow through two parallel paths. So if you see, this is surplus generation area and this one is load. So this one is load. This one is surplus generation area, this one is load, and this one is deficit area and this one is load. Okay, so in this one consider power flow through two parallel paths. Okay, these are the two parallel paths, parallel path 1 and parallel path 2. So from a surplus generation area, from this side to this generation area, deficit generation area. Okay, so this is on left side, this is on right side. Surplus generation area is in left side and deficit generation area is in the right side. So this is the figure. So next, so without any control, in this case the power flow is based on the inverse of various transmission line impedances. So without any control, power flow is based on the inverse of the various transmission line impedances. Okay. And next, apart from the ownership and contractual issues. So ownership means the total control is under the owners. Okay. And contractual issues. If you take this power flow and parallel pass as a contractual issues, that means lease. Okay, contractual issues over which lines carry how much power. Okay, based on these things, apart from ownership and contractual issues, over which lines carry how much power, it is likely that lower impedance line may become overloaded. That means, if you see this figure, so here I am telling that apart from ownership and contractual issues, over which lines carry how much power, it is likely that the lower impedance line, that is, in these lines, what is the lower impedance line? This one. Okay. This one is the lower impedance line. Okay. So, apart from ownership, so it is likely that the lower impedance line may become overloaded. So, this line will become overloaded. Okay. This line is become overloaded and thereby limit the loading at both paths even though the higher impedance path is not fully loaded. So, that means whenever we limit the loading at both paths, whenever we limit the load on both paths, here we are using two parallel paths. So if we limit the load on these two paths, so what will happen? Even though the higher impedance path is not fully loaded. So this is the higher impedance path. This is also not fully loaded. Okay. So this is the point. Apart from ownership and contractual issues, over which lines carry how much power? So it is likely that lower impedance line may become overloaded and thereby limit the loading on both paths. Okay, limit the loading on both paths even though the higher impedance path is not fully loaded. Okay, next. So here I am taking another figure with respect to the previous one. So in that diagram, I am taking two parallel paths. So one surplus area and one deficit area and two parallel paths, but here in this diagram I am taking same two parallel paths, but one parallel path is replacing with HVDC transmission line. So this is one parallel path and this is one parallel path. Here I am replacing second parallel path by HVDC line. Okay, HVDC transmission line. Here the power flow as desired. So I will explain this figure. So in this, with HVDC, power flows as added by the operator. So whatever the operator requires, so that will be flows in the HVDC line. Okay, because with HVDC power electronics converters, power is electronically controlled. Actually, before inventing the FACTS controllers, so the power flows is under control of the mechanically controlled. Okay, so here in this case, because with HVDC power electronics converters, power is electronically controlled. Okay. So an HVDC line, because of its high speed control. So here I am taking one HVDC line in place of one parallel path. So in this case, HVDC line, because of its high speed control, can also help the parallel AC transmission line to maintain stability. So in this one, we maintain some stability by using HVDC line. Okay. However, HVDC is expensive for general use. Actually, this HVDC line is very expensive for general use. That's why we are using this one. In a long distances are involved. So whenever we have to transfer the power flow, power generation to a long distance areas, we are using this HVDC line. But for short distances, we are not using any HVDC transmission lines. We are using only parallel paths. Okay. So this is for the explanation of this diagram. Okay. That's why I am note this point. This is power flow as desired. So by using HVDC line, we have to transfer the power as ordered, okay, by the operator. So this is explanation for this one. And I am taking another diagram. So here I am taking same diagram with respect to the first diagram. So here on the diagram, we are having two parallel paths. So here I am taking same, but this is surplus area and this one is a deficit area, but in the second parallel path, I am taking the variable impedance line or phase angle line. Okay. So in the previous case, I am replacing one parallel path by one HVDC transmission line. Here I am replacing one parallel path from variable impedance line, okay, or variable phase angle or variable impedance. So here we have one more diagram. So in the place of variable impedance, we are replacing variable phase angle, okay. So this one, okay, this is the one parallel path, and this is one parallel path, but in the another parallel path I am replacing that by using variable phase angle. So in this one I am replacing the parallel path by using variable impedance line, okay. So I am explaining these figures. So as alternative fax controllers, that means these two, this figure and this figure. So as an alternative to the fax controllers, I am taking that one of the transmission lines with the different types of series type fax controllers, okay. So one of the transmission lines with different types of series types, that means this one and this one, okay. So by using these, so by means of controlling impedance or phase angle, so by using this we have to control the impedance, and by using this diagram we have to control the phase angle, okay. But by using these two, we have to flow the power as desired by the operator, okay. So here, but we are using another diagram also, but it is not shown in these diagrams. That is injecting the appropriate voltage. So this is not shown here, but we are using that one also for the fact controllers. So by using these diagrams, we can control the power flow as required. By using these figures, by using these variable impedance and variable phase angle, and by the injection of appropriate voltage, by using these, we can control the power flow as required, okay. So here in this case, maximum power flow can in fact be limited. So in this case, the maximum power flow can in fact be limited to its rated limited under contingency conditions. Contingency condition means difficult conditions, okay. At those conditions also, we have to control the, we have to limit the maximum power flow to its rated limit under contingency conditions when this line is expected to carry more power. So by using these lines, we have to expect that to carry more power due to the loss of parallel line. Okay. So by using these fax controllers, these devices, we can control the power flow as required, and at the same time, maximum power flow can in fact be limited to its rated limited value under contingency conditions when this line is expected to carry more power. Due to the loss of a parallel line. Okay, this is the explanation for power flow in parallel lines, parallel paths. Okay. Next, power flow in meshed systems. Next one is power flow in a meshed system. So here I am considering a very simplified case. So here I am taking two generators. So this one and this one. Okay, A point and B point. These are the two generators. These are at the two different sites. These two are the two different sites. One is at A station, one is at B station. So these two at the two different stations are sending power to load. So this is the load station. This is the load. So these two are the generating stations, and this one is the load station, load center. So by using, so here I am sending the power to a load center through a network consisting of the three lines. So these three lines, by using these three lines, we are sending the power to a load center from these two generating centers, okay. From A and B generating stations, we are sending the power to the load, okay. Consisting of three lines, that too in a meshed connection, that is the closed loop connection. Okay, meshed connection is nothing but closed loop connection. So these three connections, by using these three connections, we have to send the sending the power to the load center, to this, okay. So here, suppose the lines, that is AB, okay, the lines AB, and next BC, and next AC. These three lines AB, BC and CA or AC have continuous rating of AB line has 1000 megawatts, Okay, BC line has 1250 megawatts or 1600 megawatts, and another line has 2000 megawatts. These two. Okay, so suppose this is for example only. Okay, suppose the lines AB, BC, and AC have continuous ratings of 1000 megawatts, 1250 megawatts, and 2000 megawatts. Okay, respectively. And have emergency ratings of twice those numbers for sufficient range. So if we face the emergency ratings and have emergency ratings of twice those numbers for a sufficient condition, sufficient length of time to allow the rescheduling of power in case of loss of one of these three lines. So if we lost any one of these three lines, that is if we lost AB line or BC line or AC line, so at that time, so emergency ratings of twice those numbers for a sufficient length of time to allow rescheduling of power in case of losing. So if you want to reschedule the power, reschedule of power in case of loss of any three lines, any of these three lines, okay. So at that time, we have to double the rating of these lines. Why? Because we have to overload any one of lines. If we lost any one line, okay, if we lost any one network, we have to overload another network, another available network. So that's why we have to increase the rating of that line, okay. So if one of the generators is generating 2000 megawatts, so for suppose if one of the generators is generating 2000 megawatts from these two, so here A generating station is generating 2000 megawatts, okay, and the other is generating 1000 megawatts, okay. Here A generating station is generating 2000 megawatts, here B generating station is generating 1000 megawatts, a total of 3000 megawatts. So this one, total of 2000 plus 1000, that is 3000 megawatts, a total of 3000 megawatts would be delivered to the load center, that is to C, would be delivered to these 3000 megawatts to the load center, that is C. Okay, so for the impedances shown, so here I am taking three impedances, that is 10 ohms, 10 ohms and 5 ohms for the three lines. For the AC line we are using 10 ohms impedance, for AB line we are using 10 ohms, for BC line we are using 5 ohms. Okay, so these three lines, the three lines would carry, those three lines would carry 600 megawatts, so this is 600 megawatts, 1600 megawatts and 1400 megawatts. Okay, these three lines would carry 600 megawatts, 1600 megawatts and 1400 megawatts. Okay, totally 3000 megawatts, 14 plus 16 plus 600. So totally 3000 megawatts. Okay, so such a situation would overload line BC. So such a situation, the line BC is overloaded. And therefore generation would have to be decreased at B. So in this place the generation would be decreased and increased at A. So increased at A. So if the generating station is generating less than the 1000 megawatts, so the and increased the load at A. Okay, and increased at A in order to meet the, why? Because in order to meet the load, in order to meet the load without overloading the BC line, without overloading this line, I am decreasing the generation in the B station and increasing the generation on A station. So why? Because in order to meet the load without overloading the line BC, without overloading the line BC. Okay, next, if you take another diagram, so this one, so here I am taking the same, so here I am taking three stations, two is generating stations, one is load center, AB is the generating station and C is the load center, and three transmission, three networks in a meshed connection. So here I am taking three networks, one is producing 1750, 250 and 1250, here I am 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 5 ohms, impedances are 10 ohms, 10 ohms, 5 ohms in the three lines, but I am introducing one reactance in the AC line, that is minus 5 ohms at the synchronous impedance is inserted in one line. Here I am inserting a capacitor whose reactance is minus 5 ohms at the synchronous frequency is inserted in one line. So we are having three lines, that is AB, BC and AC. So among these three lines I am inserting a capacitor whose reactance of minus 5 ohms in the AC line. So in this case what will happen means, so it reduces the line's impedance. It reduces the line's impedance from, so here I am using 10 ohms impedance, but it is reduced to 5 ohms because here I am using minus 5 ohms capacitor. That's why here the impedance value is decreased to 5 ohms. 10 ohms minus 5 ohms, that is equal to 5 ohms. Okay. So that power flow through the lines AB, BC and AC will be 250, 1250 and 1750. Okay, 1750, 1250 and 250. So here the power flow through the lines will be like this, like 250, 1250 and 1750 megahertz respectively. So that means it is clear that if the series capacitor is adjustable, so if the series capacitor is adjustable, so at this condition, then other power flow levels may be realized. Then other flow levels may be realized in accordance with the ownership and contract. Okay. So other power flow levels may be realized in accordance with the ownership contract. So at thermal limitations, transmission losses, and a wide range of load and generation schedules. So if the series capacity is adjustable means we have power flow levels may be realized in accordance with the ownership, contract, thermal limitations, transmission lines, and a wide range of load and generation schedules. Okay. Next, here. So this problem can be avoided if all are a part of the series capacitor thyristor control. So here I am using one series capacitor. Okay. Here I am using one series capacitor. But if the series capacitor is mechanically controlled, this may lead to subsynchronous resonance in a line. Okay. If the series capacitor is mechanically controlled, this may lead to subsynchronous resonance in a line. As a result, the generator lost synchronism and the system is collapsed. So if we overcome this problem, if all are a part of the series capacitor is thyristor controlled. Okay. If we are taking the series capacitor as a thyristor controlled, that means if the capacitor is thyristor controlled, it can be varied according to our requirement. Okay. If the capacitor is thyristor controlled, it can be varied according to our requirement and rapidly damp any subsynchronous resonance conditions. Okay. Subsynchronous resonance conditions as well as damp low frequency oscillations in the power flow. Okay. Next, hence, a thyristor controlled series capacitor can greatly enhance the stability of the network. If we use the series capacitor as a thyristor control, okay, at that condition, so this will enhance the stability of the network. Okay. So here I am taking another diagram. So in the previous diagram, I am inserting the series capacitor in the AC line. Here I am taking one inductor. I am inserting one inductor in the BC line. Okay. So similar results may be obtained by increasing the impedance of one of the lines. So in the previous case, I am decreasing the impedance value. But in this case, I am increasing the impedance value by inserting the inductor into the BC line. Okay. So similar results may be obtained by increasing the impedance of one of the lines in the same measured configuration by inserting a 7 ohms reactor or inductor in series with the line BC. Sorry, ABN padindi. This will be BC. Okay. Or series with AB. Next, a series inductor that is partially mechanically and partially thyristor controlled. So actually, in the previous case, I am inserting the capacitor, series capacitor in the AC line. But here I am inserting one series reactor in the BC line. Okay. But in this one, a series inductor that is partially mechanically and partially thyristor controlled. So it could serve to adjust steady state power flows as well as damp unwanted oscillation. Why I am inserting this series inductor like mechanically controlled and partially thyristor controlled means it could serve to adjust steady state power flows as well as as damp unwanted oscillations. So here I am taking another one, that is as another option, a thyristor control phase angle regulator. So here I am inserting one phase angle regulator, could be installed instead of series capacitor. Okay, in the first case I am inserting the series capacitor in this line, but in place instead of series capacitor line I am inserting one thyristor control phase angle regulator. So this one, so this could be installed instead of series capacitor or series reactor in any one of the three lines to serve the same purpose. Okay, the regulator is installed in the third line. So in this one, okay. So to reduce the total phase angle difference along the line from 8.5 degrees to 4.26 degrees. So here the total angle is 8.26 degrees, but it will decrease to the angle to 4.24 degrees. Okay, as before, a combination of mechanical and thyristor control of the phase angle regulator may minimize the cost. Okay, a combination of mechanical and thyristor control of the phase angle regulator may minimize the cost. Okay. Okay, these are the topics we covered in this one.